Good evening and welcome to an edition of To The Point. Is in the rerun phase of phase one of the parliamentary elections. This evening with a distinguished panel, we'll touch on how are things progressing. Wave one of the first phase managed to capture 26.5% of the those eligible to vote. Did it change this time or not? Indeed, the elections will be wrapping up tomorrow, but we still can get a sense of how things are moving. Maybe some of the influencers in the decision making when it comes to voting. With us this evening is Her Excellency Ambassador Gillane Allam, who's a former assistant foreign minister, and she was also ambassador to India. A pleasure to have you with us, as always. And with us also this evening is Mr. Tarek, member of the Egyptian Malaysian Business Council, among so many other hats. A pleasure to have you, with us this evening on To The Point. I don't want to preempt or to get you crystal ball, but I'm sure you've been following the progress thus far. Do you think the turnout today will be any different, or the turnout in the reruns of the independent list, so to speak, any different from the wave one of the elections?
I don't think so. I don't think it's going to be very much different. But I think that parliamentary elections all over the world don't see very much of a rush over. So it is usually 30% or 30%+. So if it is in Egypt in the 20%+, let us see that the situation in Egypt, the internal situation in Egypt, is a little bit different and a little bit hazy. And let us notice and acknowledge that the last few months, since we have been saying, well, the constitution is done, president is here, and then we have to take the third installment of our roadmap, which is parliamentary elections. People are really exhausted. Let's remember, there is something called elections fatigue, so to speak. So
yeah,
during the last,
a lot of elections over the
we have been through a lot of elections through the last 4 years, eight elections, so to speak, until now. Six very strenuous elections, very critical. And in very different atmospheres. So people are tired.
Yes.
So this is one element of it. The other element of it is that we don't have really, you know, some kind of a party's life. So, I mean, in all countries in the world, there are parties with a program, with people working with the people who get to be known, who get to introduce themselves and their programs and so on. This didn't happen. We have been spending the last, let's say, 15-18 months, you know, trying to make all this, you know, kind of list, or should I run individual independent? So I think there is some kind of a very confused scene as far as parliamentary elections are concerned. So, but I am not concerned. I'm worried, and I think we will sort it out as usual. But I think also that we have to be very careful in what's coming up. I mean, members elected for the parliament, the new parliament, will have to be very careful in what they do, how they handle, and the parties or the running, let's say, components of the political, internal political, will have to do a much better work and a much better effort trying to run, trying to correct what has happened during the last. But I'm not concerned, and at the low level, and hopefully during the first the round, which will include Cairo. So I think if I were to take the decision, I would have started by Cairo, by the capital. And because, you know, I mean, it would have created some kind of a, you know, very lively momentum, and this would have given the people to follow through. But we started in a different fashion, so let it be. But let us learn, and let us correct, and let us go forward. This is what really how I see the, what is. But maybe you see it differently.
I don't see it at all differently. I can say that all the observations that you've made are very relevant. They're very telling, and I can tell you one of the most important lessons is that we don't really have the party machinery, which is usually in place to promote a certain doctrine or a certain policy and to match the preference of the people. That kind of campaign hasn't been in place. There are, when you go to the EU North article, European countries, you see how the machinery of the parties are engaged. That we haven't seen here.
No.
You touch upon a very important point, is that when those people will be elected and get a place in the parliament, they should be mindful of the interest of the country and not to let their vote been given to any other interest than that one. This is part of what you've been saying. I think there is a third important lesson that ought to be, that I have definitely been able to see. There isn't enough civic education, either for the parliamentary members or for the citizens. The citizens should take more serious, in a more serious way, their civic duties. One thing that I would add to what you just said is that there was no issue that really engaged the people.
No.
When presidential election engaged the people, constitution did, in fact, but in this one, no.
Why didn't they see the value added? When you say civic, they saw their social responsibility or their responsibility in voting for a constitutional referendum, in voting for the president. Why is it that when it came to the parliamentary elections, the value added of this election was not that deep?
The reason being that the earlier constitution, the way I read it, did not give so much power, the power in the hand of the president. Mm. The new constitution really endows authority on the parliament, which is not yet understood by the people. And people do not, this kind of consciousness of the role of the institution in a democracy, time to be understood and acted upon. We are not yet there. Mm. And this is the problem. And I believe that the behavior of the first, of the elected parliament will have an impact on the next election, how they will be credible in the eyes of the people. There is so much, in my mind, to be learned from what will be seen during those elections.
When you say no machinery or no party life and no programs, since the revolution, since the January 25th revolution, which was 4+ years ago, almost 5 years ago now, coming this January, we've had a lot of parties surfacing. And we cannot say that we cannot use the same excuse of during the previous regimes, the parties were not allowed to talk. There was no, the practice of political life was not, the practice of political life has been out loud and clear since the January 25th revolution. In all due honesty, can we say that the parties went out of their way? Not a correct or a proper, really, description, because they owe it to their constituencies to go out, explain their programs, and explain what Dina is about, how, what value added will she be to the party, what Ambassador Gillane is about, what Mr. Malash is about. I mean, if you want people to vote, you really have to tell them what you will do for those people. Have the parties and the members of the parties been doing that?
Let me ask you a question. Have you ever heard of a country that has 106 parties? This is what we have.
Only?
Only. This is at least what I hear in the, in
yeah,
the, in
Spain,
the media.
Spain in 1975 had 700.
So, I mean, so, this is a confusing, also.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a very confusing situation.
And it yielded nothing in the beginning.
But you have big parties.
Well,
let's forget about the small ones.
All right.
The big parties, where are they? Where is their agenda?
Which big parties are you talking about?
We have old big parties, we have new big parties. I don't want to, and this, in this way, I don't want to really start naming names.
No, what I mean is that even the big parties, whoever they are, though I haven't touched, I mean, I haven't seen or felt the touch of any of them, to tell you the truth.
But we do have big parties.
We shouldn't belittle them.
Yes.
All right, or belittle their history, so to speak. But let me ask you, where do you have you seen or heard them engage with their constituents anywhere?
This is what I'm saying. Have they done this?
There have been so much internal fuss in every party, internal vendettas, actually, you know, in every. There have been internal split. There is no actual touching base with the people. Mm. I mean, you are now a huge, you have a constituency of 56 million voters. This is not a small voting constituency.
No, it's not.
You have to reach them. How do you reach them? No party that I know of plan or had a plan or followed a plan to reach any of its constituency. So we are still minding, you know, the little.
Even though this is the third parliament. Since January 25th.
Yeah, but there is another important thing.
Please.
No, sorry, I'm just adding to what you said. The parties are not, they don't know how to do it. And I believe that. They don't know how to do it.
Even the big ones.
Even the big ones. And I don't know whether they had the means. And if they had the means.
The financial means,
they wouldn't have spent it. Because they realized that this is an entirely new game. No, there was, you used a very, very good word, engagement. This word engagement, if you engage, you need two sides to be engaged. The parties in really selling their platform to their constituents. And that was the main question, Mrs. Dina. And the recipient of the message, no, he was completely, I would say, pathetic. But in really, a large portion, they couldn't care less. Because at the end of the day, they realized that they do not mean much in their daily life.
Mm. And I think that sometimes trying to be too perfect to avoid so many, you know, difficulties and little trimmings right and left led to a very complex and complicated voting system, you know, to the because the 56 million voters are all not all very much educated or accessing, you know, Facebook and the internet or even going to that. I mean, it's so you have created, you know, trying to be very fair, very honest, you know, very transparent, avoiding all the problems in the past. So you have we have been faced. And even, I think, even to us, I mean, who claim to be a little bit educated or know a little bit something about anything, you know, I mean, it's a complicated issue. So you are telling them, take a blue form and just make one tick and take another, and then in some areas, only you tick only one, in the other. So, I mean, why do you have more than 5,000 individual running, you know, for parliament in independent over just, you know, something like of 400 or 300.
Some blame the media.
It's very complicated, and people have not been educated enough about what does it really mean to go to cast your vote. I mean, for him, casting my vote means that I am going to get bread, a home, security, a future.
This is what people are expecting. This is why they're participating in the whole process.
This is what, but they didn't hear that. Where is the programs? I mean, I'm living in an area where, you know, I don't know the people who are running, and I don't know anything about their programs to tell. Nothing.
It's almost like
and it's Cairo, and
some are blaming the media for not introducing the people.
You cannot do that.
500 people. How are we going to introduce 500 individuals?
There are reasonable. I mean, the engagement of the media was not at all as it was the question. It's either a paid media or
governmental
media. And both were not engaged. They were not ready, and they wouldn't mobilize resources for that end. Mm-hmm. There were some of the leading parties who had their leaders being exposed, and they tried to explain. But another thing, there are no big issues involved in this. And I don't think the difference between the different platforms was so big, and again,
even though we have hundreds or over 100
yes.
laws that this parliament will be passing, supposedly,
well, it's 300 plus.
Yes, but it is
allegedly 15 days.
Yes, but the issue is.
But this doesn't matter to the layman.
This is not in their mind, as you just said. It has to have a bearing on their daily life, and all the elements that you have just mentioned. They will not affect them. It is what the government does. They don't see that they have a role in it. So we shouldn't really give that
much. Whose problem is that the people do not understand the proper job description of a parliamentarian or proper scope of work of the parliament?
I think
because this changed, at least it should be changing in practice, even if it's not in because some people say, well, in the previous constitutions it was almost the same, but it was not applicable. So this parliament, things should be different.
There is a lot of things that in this constitution that affects the daily life of people. It is up to the parliament to see to it that they are strictly observed by the government. This kind of understanding, please, it's not two things are important. Understanding is one thing. Getting familiar with how to tackle this and then to believe in it. We are not yet. We are maybe in the beginning of the first stage. And then such a wide strata of the society. You've got the people who will never get engaged. There are people, the youth. What we should work with much more is to engage the youth to realize that what this parliament will have a bearing on their lives. And they have to really get, because we've got a sizable portion of the population that are really youth. This is where, and the teaching of these things has to be in the school. It has to do with the curriculum. In many countries, they teach the youth and the children their civic obligations. And one of them is to appreciate their own value. I've read books when I was in Sweden, how they instill in the youth. We are not yet there. People have become too demanding and at the same time impatient. They should realize that it takes time to change the mindset of the people to have that consciousness of their civic obligations. And this model has taken years in many other countries to build. I had the privilege to see it in one of the most advanced countries like Sweden, and how they do it. And they are all, it's for them, if they don't vote, they might not sleep the night because they feel they have missed an obligation.
I like to speak about civic duties and civic rights. You know, the idea of an obligation is too strong for me. I have to tell you the truth, but this is the concept of it. I mean, you have to do it. That means you have to do it.
True.
Period. But again, I will say that what we are facing now, we have to study it carefully.
Absolutely.
We have to sit. After all of this, you know, after the dust settles, whatever the outcome is, we have to sit, study it thoroughly. Mm-hmm. We have to look at the parties, you know, the 100 and whatever, 76, whatever. The parties who do not have or who do not gain minimum of one member of parliament should be voted out of the political life until they put themselves and come back. Now, the parties, the big parties, so to speak, if you want to call them this way, or the new alliances that are being built or that are showing up, will have to do a better effort. We'll have to be more engaged. Again, the word you mentioned, you have to be more engaged. They have to tell the public what they intend to do, what they have to do, and they have to feel accountable to the public. So far, these people don't feel accountable to the public. To their constituency, to those who elect them. So there is this kind of, you know, just let it be, you know, from the part of the youth, because also the youth, actually, they need a very, very special effort. I mean, the youth and the people who...
The youth have a lot of energy. Since the revolution, have you felt that we've been... Have we been using this energy in a constructive fashion?
It has not been much work in this direction. They have shown their interest. They have shown what they want. Shown what kind of energy. They have shown what kind of change they can bring about. You know, and I keep remembering this. you know, this experiment of Tamarod and what during the time of. The former president Morsi, and how they were able to move the country to brush away, so to speak, you know, that system. So they have the potential, but they have to have the idea, they have to have leadership, they have to have people to drag them to the right road, you know, the yellow brick road, you know, this is where we have to drag our youth. There has to be leadership at different levels, different points. And this is what I say, that parties will have to work very hard. I mean, this is going, they will be, have to be accountable to these people. Parties will have to work very hard. All of those alliances that are trying now, again, they are not trying to reach out to the people, they are trying to reach out to the seats in parliament. So what they are trying,
forgetting that the people will put them in the seats.
You know,
no, but there is another thing which is very, which, very important.
So, please.
I just want to add, is that the youth are, have become a bit apathetic. They don't understand that their contribution will only be meaningful if they prepare themselves to enter the political, whoever wants, the political arena and try to change the lives. They have the enthusiasm of youth, but the know-how on how to be involved in policies, I mean, is another thing. And this is what I believe. The party should prepare a second row, a third row. This kind of mindset, we need to have more than one. We need to have a kind of change that will result in having people gaining consciousness of what they should be doing and what's their role. You said something about when the parties will be in the parliament, they want to get their seat. But during the coming period, they have ample time to get the people to know what's their platform. The issue is they don't spend money, and I repeat it.
Effort also.
And money and effort, of course.
Effort.
No, but reaching out requires money and resources.
Yes.
Effort is the one which is done by the party. You need to be, you have this mindset of marketing your views. This kind of attitude, we are not. Every country that has conflicting views about how to run the policies of running the country, both parties, they spend resources and they consume resources in order to get the people engaged with them. What is said about this is that people who would like to get involved are not encouraged because they don't see in the arena something that attracts them or talks for them. So it is this interaction. You need the interaction. And it should start with the syllabus in the schools, getting the people to understand that this is part of it. And people should not be impatient. It will take time. But somebody has to start the right thing at the right time.
I agree with you. And you know, there is this very interesting and very important and meaningful, you know, Chinese say that the trip of the 1,000 miles starts with a small step. So we have to start with this small step. The two revolutions put actually, you know, I mean, this journey of the 1,000 mile put it forward. I mean, it kept, you know, it pushed it forward. I mean, we have achieved in 4 years a lot. And what has it achieved? I mean, I this is how I feel.
Your Excellency, speaking of that, and maybe I'll touch on an international hat here, and that is, why is it that in coverage, media coverage of the wave one of the election, media coverage, one thing I noticed is that there was a lot of negative vibes regarding elections in Egypt. Some said that the low turnout is... they're linking it to the presidential popularity. In the United States, for example, is voter turnout in all states high?
No.
In Europe, in Asia, why is it that we're looking at Egypt as a weird example, even though you were saying that in most countries, 30% voter turnout in parliamentary elections is usually...
The reasonable,
and we are in KG1 in democracy.
I've heard it. I was in abroad. I've heard it. Somebody took up the issue with me.
Yes.
And the remark was, yes, it's understandable that legislative elections are known to have a low turnout. Again, in every country that you speak about, they have another engagements of the party and the individuals when there are elections. I haven't seen any meaningful mobilization. I haven't seen any. Anything published. No, it is, we don't know how to mobilize the art of mobilizing people and to engage them is not yet in the on the ground in Egypt, in my mind.
Some are linking the low turnout to certain internal policies. For example, we had an issue with the value of the dollar, for example, that devaluating or upping the value of the dollar versus the Egyptian pound contributed negatively to voter turnout, that people see maybe some economic policies and inflation and hardships are really a turnoff to elections.
Well, I can only say from a business point of view, those are, in a way, depressing news, because this will have a bearing on the cost of whatever is important. But on the other hand, exports could benefit out of it. But the impact on the Egyptian citizen and the Egyptian population, definitely. But this is not, I would say it's an element, but what we have right now of the engagement is the 90% issue.
So do you think, I mean, let me say this. I mean, do you really think that the 56 million voters know or the impact of the increase of the price of the dollar, the value of the dollar versus the Egyptian pound? I don't think they do know.
Some analysts are saying those policies are a turnoff.
Well, this is a turnoff maybe for the business community, excuse me. But I mean...
I will vote.
But I mean, and even in that respect, I don't think this is really, you know, a very strong point. But you mentioned the international press and how they view. What is it that they have viewed positively since the 25th of January, 2011? I mean, what have they seen positive?
My answer is no comment.
I mean, they have seen nothing. You know. In what happened in Egypt, and they will continue not to see anything positive in anything we do, in anything we intend, in anything we want to achieve, and they will always bring you down. They will always bring your morale down.
What's the reason? I would love to hear it from you.
Well, not in the program, because we came here for a totally different reason.
I understand.
I came here to speak about basically the president.
I got the diplomatic answer.
Let's just say conflict of interest.
No, I wouldn't say that.
Well, I tell you something. Foreign affairs. I tell you something. I mean, I give you. I mean. Till this week, Foreign Affairs, you know, which is a very established Foreign Affairs, you know, magazine, which is a very well established, you know, I mean, magazine in foreign policy and so on.
Yes.
You find still writing, you know, encouraging the United States to decrease its military assistance to Egypt. They are still talking about this. They see us going the other way. They see us telling the Americans, okay, thank you very much. We like you. We have a strategic relationship with you. We cannot just, you know, disengage from you.
We're moving to Asia.
You know, I mean, so, and we are trying to move east in kind of politics, you know, East politics. You know, I mean, so we are trying, and still people telling them this. And then you see the United States going, and this week, you know, Israel's trying to establish some kind of strategic partnership in the nuclear area. I mean, while we have been talking since 1974 about the nuclear, you know, problems, you know, with the nuclear facilities in Israel. So, I mean, they will see nothing, you know, good in what you do, and they will see nothing positive in what you do. Mm. I would be concerned, but I will certainly work very hard on tit for tat. They say A, we say B. I mean, we keep convincing them and telling them the truth and the facts. They want to listen, they're welcome. They don't want to listen. Well, we are moving steady. We have to move steady, very hard, very harsh. Mm-hmm. And I don't see a reason why we should really kind of fidget, you know, in panic or whatever.
No, we're not panicking at all.
I mean, I would not really at all.
If I pick your businessman hat here, there is a concern that economically we are not moving forward in a comprehensive fashion. Some people are saying, well, you have memorandums of understanding, you have a lot of projects in the pipeline, but you either have an infrastructure problem or you have legislative problems or what have you, that is really not making things materialize. And this, in a way, is also affected the elections, that maybe the learned ones feel that they're concerned.
Well, you've enumerated all the points that really matter for investors to come along and to get engaged in the country. The legislative part seems to be of great importance with the new areas. And until now, there are many important and relevant issues that have not been settled properly. And there is a great a lack of details and a certain, to say, an uncertainty that businessmen would not like to live with unless it is settled. We're getting new zones, we're getting new investments, but they feel that we need to do more to improve the investment climate. And we also, I believe, as government, to do more on the political arena. Many countries, many businessmen will only step in if their country encourages them to come in. Yeah. So I know that the president's numerous trips are intended to open the gates at the highest level and a political blessing for engaging with Egypt. And of course, China has been one of the pinnacles of his visits. And I think this takes time to build. But we can move faster if we really streamline our legislative investment environment properly. And that, of course, in the eyes of the world, we need to have those legislative elections in order to convince them that we have a normal country. When we talk to some people, they say in Europe, say, well, you're missing that. But it's not, we have to make our homework in terms of what you've just said. Number two is that to engage countries like the heavyweights to come along, and then the rest will come. Mm-hmm. Oh, definitely, we have a lot to do, and I think the government, see, the problem with the governments is that they have so much to do, and it is the priorities that they set for themselves, which will have an impact.
Mm-hmm. There is, if you allow me, there is a very heavy heritage of misfits, you know, in the business arena that we have inherited, you know, with the years and the decades before. This is why, you know, I mean, there is the Ministry of Investment that has to work, that has to expand, and that the field of the scope of its work, and has to work much harder and much faster. And I say that everything is in one word: transparency, rule of the law.
And what I will add to you from my experience, thank you very much for saying this, because there is so much which needs to be done in the Ministry of Investment in terms of the way it interacts with the investor. It can take weeks to get an approval for a single paper. And one of the excuses I've been hearing, for instance, that they have to send a print shop, and that takes weeks. There is a pipeline which is full of things. Yes, you're absolute. And I'm extremely surprised that on the issue of interacting with the investors, whether Egyptians, Arab, or foreigners, nothing has been done. And they will only succeed if they minimize the contact between the investor and the civil servant. Everything has to be mechanized so that nobody, and you mentioned something very important, the transparency. They haven't spelled out what are the rules of the game, and until they do that, those civil servants will really dictate
over,
so much.
Yes. Yeah. The president started an Asian tour, so to speak, yes, today, and the timing, as Egypt undergoes parliamentary elections, it seems that our international relations agenda is going in parallel. I mean, nothing is standing still. We're moving in different directions.
Absolutely.
And correct me if I'm mistaken, I don't think the president visited India, or did he visit India since he took office?
No, he did not.
This is the first time, and I believe he'll be attending.
Yes. He will be attending the India-Africa Forum Summit.
Yes.
And let me start by saying that in any political life in any country, you have to go multi-track way. I mean, and particularly if you are in a situation where we are. I mean,
this was not our case in the past. That's what I'm saying.
No.
Usually, we focus on one thing and on one international partner.
This is it.
Multi-track
has to be.
Is very relevant. Mm.
You have to work in multi-track. You know, I mean, in different. If you can, at the same pace in 100. If you can, and it has to do. And remember that we have lost like 4 years yes. now trying to put things together to figure out where we are going, how we're going to do it, and so on. So I think that what is happening is very much so, and I wish that all the tracks would have gone through the same, you know, impact and emphasis. Yes, the president has not visited before, and he has received the formal invitation to visit India and to attend the India-Africa Forum Summit, which is being held every three years. It's been held twice, once before in India in Delhi, India, 2008, and then the second time in Addis Ababa, 2011. Then the Ebola crisis last year did not allow it, so it is taking place this year. Very important. And actually, we are lucky in terms of its timing.
Why? How does it help Egypt?
Oh, in so many ways. First of all, I think that it's the president needed to visit India. India is the fourth largest economy in the world. It is not a small country with a small economy. He went to Indonesia, to even to Singapore, for particular purposes and particular ideas to grab from there and try to use them here. So in tradition, it has a very large economic, agricultural sector, industrial sector, IT. I'm sure you know about that. So
very large market as well.
And then you have a market of 1 billion, 250 million. Yeah. Look at it this way. In 1 billion, 25, 250 million, Africa in its totality, 1.170 million, that's together, they make one third of the world population. Countries that need everything. And you can open, and we have been speaking about, you know, the degradation of the pound versus the dollar. This is the time. Egypt, export as much as you can, work as much as you can, and import as much as you can, and increase your GDP, bring work to people. So this is the opportunity. I think it's a great opportunity for the president, first of all, to visit India per se. He will be meeting the president, the prime minister. He met the prime minister actually during his visit to the United Nations in New York. And he will be meeting the business community, the investors. India invests in Egypt $2.5 billion. So it is a rather important, it's not the top, but it is a huge investor in Egypt. So we have to work with them. They have a lot to offer us, and we have a lot to offer to them. Good opportunity for the president to thank the 54 or the 53 now countries from Africa who had voted Egypt to be their candidate into the Security Council.
Yes.
And I think they have delivered that, and we have to be grateful to them for that. That is certainly, for me, this is very important that we show gratefulness. This is a very good opportunity for him to meet with leaders. 40 African countries are represented in this forum at the level of president, head of government, or head of state. So it is a huge opportunity for the president, for our president, to be able to communicate, to engage again with these countries personally, directly. They have to see the man. They have to see, chemistry works very important, in a very important way, you know, in international politics. You could see that, if you body language and chemistry is very, very important.
Okay, let's see if the businessman sees value added in India.
Well, of course.
Are there lessons that we can learn from one of the strongest economies worldwide now?
We've got a lot to learn from them. I visited their towering achievements in Hyderabad, in Bangalore, in Chennai. Definitely they've been wonders, but those wonders were made by the Indians who migrated to the outside the country and then came back and built all this. I would like to think, Africa is the continent of the future. Egypt has taken in the last Sharm el-Sheikh conference, where all the representatives, all the countries belonging to three different free trade regions were brought together, and they have promulgated a new agreement where the three will be combined.
That's in our economic summit.
Yes, in the economic summit. And this, of course, I mean, this conference is definitely based to encourage the Indian, to pave the way for Indian involvement in competition with the Chinese involvement in Africa. Everybody's competing for Africa. So we shouldn't be, we should be mindful of that. But it is the best forum, as Her Excellency said, to get those kind of feeling for how the people would react. Yeah. So Egypt has taken that initiative. So Egypt could, through that, have the Indian industries engaging so that they can export to the to half the Africa. They see in it the potential. And I believe that if we engage in a kind of relation and convince them that we have free zones in the Suez Canal, I mean, what we have as plan, we haven't yet spelled it out in details. This has yet to come. And when it comes, and it is attractive to multinationals, India has huge multinationals. Today, the Jaguar, Land Rover, all these cars belong to India. Yeah. No, I'm just telling you, the most prestigious brands of cars belong to Indian companies. Mm. They bought out everybody. Mm. I mean, in those kind of, all I want to say is that, yes, India has the strength to lead and to engage us. If they give us a kind of preferential position
we
in
do
any
have,
of this,
we do
if this happens, yes, yes, if we, if they develop it still further, mm, we stand to benefit. But again, I go back to the issue of the investment environment. Somebody has to look into it in ways that makes
life
easier.
Isn't that the one of the scopes of work of the upcoming parliament to look? Maybe because before the economic summit, we had a change, an issuance of a new investment law. And I know businessmen were not satisfied with that investment law. Would something like the parliament, or should something like the upcoming parliament, study maybe regulations and legislations pertaining to how to deal with an investor?
This is very important. Again, it's priority. They have so many laws to look into it, but the government should definitely, in this case, tell them, this is the first priority, this is the second priority. Somebody has to really, you know, no matter how much resources we have, they will always be limited. So they need to really direct them what to de-block the appetite of foreign investors to come to Egypt.
Can I just, you know, go back a little bit to tell you, Africa, you know, has 60% of the world arable lands that can be cultivated.
Yes.
Where are we from that? Where are we from that? I mean, we are a 7 years old agricultural country. And we see this land open to us with water resources and so on. Where are we from that? So now India realizes that and it is working. I mean, this is one of they are putting in front of them. And there is a proposal on the table now between Egypt and India to make some kind of tripartite joint ventures, that is Africa, India, and Egypt. And we are having, you know, kind of opportunities thrown, you know, tables. We have to work much harder, to tell you the truth, honestly. You know, I mean, this is now becoming a blank fact. Either, you know, work or die, honestly. I mean, negotiate or die. It's go for it or die. To work, we have to engage people. We have to bring everybody. I mean, it seems like, you know, our country is turning into some kind of an unbridgeable gap between, you know, the older generation and the younger generation. I mean, these look at these and they don't want to grab them up, and these look at these as just get out, you know, of the way, we can do it, but they can't do it. This is the problem. You have these two sectors of the country, you know, to give them, you know, the potential to be able to do something. So it's really work, work, work. Transparency, 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 rule of the law, rule of the law, rule of the law. I think these are really, this is the magic formula, so to speak, you know, for okay, anything that
we have a couple of minutes to finish, but before we do so, maybe I'll ask you to take out your crystal ball and think of the upcoming, the 2015 Egyptian parliament. How will it look like? Wave one, it seems that the alleged parties, even though they're not Islamist, but those under that or with that ideology, have not managed to gain substantial standing, so to speak. But generally speaking, how do you see a majority of a certain party? How do you see the shape of the upcoming parliament?
I personally believe that it will be very difficult to have blocs because the number of member of parliament not affiliated to, but huge. And of course, they might have hidden directions or hidden affinity with others. I believe it's going to be a very difficult parliament to bring together unless they are forced to take a stand on very serious issues for the country, like the laws.
Will they be able to put their differences aside and agree? Because their job will be to issue a lot of legislations. Mm. And when you say there will be no major bloc, which means a cocktail, and maybe this is Nile's face in our political life, will they be able to agree on rules and regulations and laws? Because this is also a concern.
There will be a lot of manipulation in that, unfortunately. I believe that it depends on the issue. I cannot generalize, but it will not be
an easy ride. Block.
It will not be an easy ride. Be a lot of trade-offs behind black doors deal.
Behind closed doors.
Closed, not black, huh?
Closed doors. Let's call it the closed doors. I think that this parliament is going to be a very homogenic parliament. There is no obvious majority except for in the love of Egypt, you know, so to speak. I think they will try
in phase one. We still don't know phase two.
Well,
phase one,
this is what you see. I mean, you said ball.
Yes.
So I'm using my crystal ball now.
Okay.
I think they will have there will be a lot of lobbying trying to attract to every party, every group of winners will try to attract independents, which are huge, you know. I mean, they might be more than two-thirds of the members of the parliament, so trying to attract them to their side. But I will think this is the unfortunate fact, or the unfortunate way that I see, is that parliament will spend a lot of time trying to inter-negotiate, you know, their political affiliation and inclinations in there. You will need a very, very, very strong chairman of the parliament. I think it will need, you know, a great politician to be able, very respectable,
to maneuver the discussions.
Yes,
a good headmaster.
Absolutely, absolutely. You need a very strong personality to be able to do that. You will have to need, and I do hope that in this parliament you will have some kind of an elite. An elite group that will be chairman or the chairman of the parliament, to be able to bring along, you know, the different people and to attenuate the kind of differences which I expect. Because not everybody in this parliament, you know, from reading the names, from seeing the faces and so on, would really be up to the job that we are attending. Also, I think that whoever is in charge, the Minister for Parliamentary Affairs, I think has a huge job, and I think that I hope he has started to work, is that to prepare for every member of this parliament a huge file, you know, a huge dossier, you know, with everything that is expected to him, so that they start doing their homework very, very early in the day, that there will be people explaining to them what is expected of them, that they have to be brought to that this is not a matter of, you know, choosing where to go, where to sit, but to work for the people mm-hmm. who have elected them, because they have not been elected only by the 22 or 26 or 28 or 30%, but they have been elected by the 100 membership of this country, and they owe it to them.
Yes. In 1 minute, because I need to wrap up, women representation. Mm. How do you see women in parliament?
It's not enough. It should be. I mean, the outcome will never give the due women representation, and this is very regrettable. I told you that the art of engaging in elections is something that is to be built in this population. It takes time, and the true engagement, and I can tell you, joining elections requires a minimum of professionalism, and that kind of professionalism is not taught anywhere in Egypt. We have this kind of tribal or origin, certain areas, big families. That's the only thing bring a man to, or a woman to place to the parliament, but the professional way of interacting and really being brought to the parliament thanks to your own ideas, to your belief, and that what you are
still have to learn that
reflects what the people want.
Lady and gentlemen, thank you very much for your fruitful input. Thank and indeed we shifted to a lot of issues, but I had to grasp or capitalize on your expertise in different areas to tackle a number of issues. Thank you very much. On to the point, I'd like to thank you, the viewer. We'll see you same time next week. And stay tuned to Nile TV's international special coverage of Egyptians elected the 2015. And good night.